And good morning, everybody. It is Friday morning, and it is a joy, put that up there, to be here with you this morning. God bless. Good morning, Miss Teresa, and yes, everybody that is out there, I want to remind you to be in prayer for Colleen. Her tube dislodged, the body, whether it's rejecting or not, we don't know. Talked to Rick yesterday. He was telling me about it. Please, please, please be much in prayer. This is, I think, her fourth surgery since last summer on this issue, on this problem. And she needs it in that. That's where she gets her nourishment. So really does need your prayer. This lady has suffered and gone through so much. Please, please continue to pray for Colleen. And at the same time, pray for the whole family. This is hard on everybody. This is hard on Mom and Dad and Rick and Lynn are out there this morning. God bless you. We love you. I'm assuming that Bible study continues today at 1 and 7 this evening. If not, let me know. We'll get that out. Miss Brenda and Mr. Brent, shout out and good morning to you as well. Good to see you up here this morning. And Miss Jessica, good morning to you. I'll get to see you a little a bit later. But we'll go ahead and jump in and get started and say hi to folks as they come on. So Bible studies are going to continue today as normal, so please remember them. remember, Rick and Lana, because they're leading the study, but they are also carrying the burden for their daughter. So appreciate it, you guys. Just a little extra prayer for them today, if you would please. All right. Well, we have been looking at several things as it relates to the death of Christ. We just moved from trying to get a personal grasp what it means individually, personally to each other. Good morning, dear brothers and sisters. Watch a wonderful friends from Miss Sherry. And yes. Then yesterday, we had just begun talking about what does the death of Jesus reveal? What God did through Jesus changed everything, changed it all for eternity. Paul writes about the centrality of all of this in his resurrection chapter in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 3 and 4, as he passes on just the simplicity, the profound simplicity of the good news. Let's see. Miss Linda comes on. Sorry, Miss, yesterday we were at the beach. That'd be hard duty to take, Miss Linda, but I'm glad you had to take it, all right? And both Laura and Chris are there this morning. Howdy. Good to have you home, Chris and Miss Terry. Good morning to everyone, and a good morning to you. Paul says, I pass on to you what was most important. What was most important, and what had also been passed on to me. Christ died for our sins, just as Scripture said. And he was buried, and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as Scripture said. The death, burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ all have their unique and significant meaning and truth that God wants you and I to know and to apply and to share. Well, for now, we're focusing on his death. We'll move to his burial and resurrection in the days to come. Three things I shared with you yesterday that we need to really know and grasp and really nail down for our own life and for a witness about the death of Jesus. We were looking at the first of those when we ran out of time yesterday, that the death of Jesus reveals the very judgment of God. Listen carefully. Before you can begin to see the cross as something done for us, we have to see that it's something done by us. That's one of the reasons I love this graphic and some others that I have that show a modern man holding either the spike or the mallet, which, you know, he's holding both at the foot of the cross. Because we have a tendency to put ourselves out of the picture. We didn't live 2,000 years ago. We didn't stand around and gawk. We weren't walking on the road and hurling insults. We weren't any of the ones that yelled out, crucify him, crucify him. We weren't there. We're many years removed from that, centuries. So we have a tendency not to see ourselves in that picture. But we need to. The reality is that we are all sinners. We've all sinned, and Jesus voluntarily gave his life for us on the cross so our sin could be dealt with once for all. One of the greatest pictures of this is what happened while Jesus was on the cross. In verse 33, Mark tells us that at the sixth hour, noon, came darkness and fell on the whole earth until the ninth hour, that'd be 3 p.m., the time of the evening sacrifice. So for 3 hours, darkness was on the land, from noon to 3 in the afternoon. As I mentioned earlier, it's a supernatural event. We don't know how this darkness occurred. whether it was an eclipse that lasted, a solar eclipse that lasted 3 hours. I think it went far, far beyond that. However, God chose to do it. It was a supernatural event. Regardless how he did it, it became nighttime in the middle of the day for 3 hours while Jesus was on the cross. Whatever it was and however it happened, this darkness was a tool that God was using to say something to them and something to us. And for one thing, the darkness served as a reminder of what God did during the Passover centuries ago. I believe that when that darkness fell, everybody, since it was the Passover, everybody was already, you know, of a mind frame, a Passover mind frame. They immediately went to the ninth plague where there was 3 days of darkness. I wonder how many of them thought, how long will this darkness last? Does it come forever? Will it last for 3 days? At the end of that darkness, there was the tenth plague, which caused the death of the firstborn. At the end of 3 hours of darkness here upon the earth, as Jesus hung on the cross, there was an announcement here that God's firstborn and beloved Son, the very Lamb of God, was giving his life for the sins of the world. Another thing, this darkness was a sign of God's judgment, a judgment we should have received was being placed on him. There, I think there's a significance here. I shared with you what Amos says in the 8th chapter, 8th verse. On that day, I will make the sun go down at noon and darken the earth while it's still day. That's important. It was not a regional darkness. Part of the world was already in darkness because it was nighttime. But the other part of the world that was not fell into deep darkness so that there was no light upon the whole of the earth. And I think that darkness was deeper than just night. I think it was even though it was night where other people were, I think the night deepened, the darkness deepened, as the light of the world was dying upon the cross, bearing our sin. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so very much for loving us. I thank you that we can come now, open our hearts and minds, Lord, to understand what it is that you're saying to us today. Give us a deep, deep understanding of what your death truly, truly is saying to us. What transpired. And make it not just simply an intellectual understanding, but one that moves us from the very core of our being. And give us then the ability to share that life-transforming, world-transforming truth to any that we have the opportunity. Now, to you be praise and glory for our time together today, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's see. Miss Terry said good morning, and let's see. Therese's here. Good morning. It is good to see you, Miss Therese, and I think I'll maybe get to see you too. Benjamin, boy, we get to see you pretty frequently. It's good to, I am so thrilled at that. And there's Miss Savannah. Good morning to you, my dear. It is good to see you. Anyway, let me point out something that's really significant here. Even though darkness is often used to indicate, you know, death and judgment in the Bible, and it is also true that darkness does not mean that God is absent. It may look like the devil is winning And I think probably at this point, any who are followers of him were thinking exactly that. And it may look like all hope is gone, and you may not see much light at the end of your particular tunnel. You may feel sometimes defeated and full of doubts and confused about what God is doing. But even in the midst of that kind of darkness that often erupts in our life, God is at work. It may look like your dreams are dying, but God's at work on your behalf to bring about hope and life and joy, and to bring that enthusiasm back into your life. You'll need to wait, maybe, through the darkness. You may need to walk along with the psalmist as he writes, "Even though I walk in the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil." The death of Jesus reveals our sin and the judgment of God, but it also reveals that God is at work. Something was happening, and God was doing something even in the midst of that darkness. There was a resurrection coming. It was dark, but what was happening in those 3 hours of darkness is profound. Because God is at work, yes, judging my sin. But he's at work providing for me a way of salvation. God is at work even in the darkness. The second thing that I want you to see here is the death of Jesus reveals the forgiveness of God. That takes us to number two. Look again at Mark and chapter 15, verse 34. In the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me?" We are told that while Jesus is on the cross, he said seven things. And when we finish looking at this section, we'll take a look at those seven sayings and what they mean. I don't think we can walk away from the cross and just look at the one. We need to look at the whole picture. And to do that, we have to go to the other Gospels as well. One of those things was, again, this statement. Again, it's about being abandoned by God. At this moment, Jesus Christ was feeling the full wrath of God's judgment against all the sins of humankind. Past, present, and future. Jesus cried out in agony as he bore the sins of the world and was separated, as I said, for the first time from the Father because of our sin. And Jesus is expressing the horror of that separation. This statement by Jesus expresses the incredible pain of the abandonment by God. Later, when describing this moment, Paul writes the church in Corinth in the 5th chapter, 21st verse, "He made the one who did not know sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Terry said, "It's so hard for me, sinful man, me, not to know what God is doing and where he is taking us." Yes, it is. It is hard. That's why we have to trust. In those hours of darkness, Derry, talking to you or any, because many of us. Oh, by the way, Terry, while it's on my mind, just popped in. Did you get the boot off, I hope? We as men and women who fight against our old sinful nature and the temptation and just the darkness that sometimes prevails in our life because of not knowing something, or the pain that we're in brings this great darkness and we cry out, why? I think of Rick and Lena as they walk in this shadow with their daughter going through and wondering, God, why, and going through all of that. That's where you have to at some point in the midst of that darkness, you hang on. Because God's working something out. Something great and something gracious and something wonderful. So in the midst of that darkness, hang on. Good morning, Mike. And it's okay that you're late. I love seeing you out there. Better late than never, my friend. You're not that late. No. Two of the screws broke. Oh, kiddo, I'm sorry. Are they going to have to put new screws in? Ugh, how horrible. All right, guys, keep praying for Terry. All right? So, she didn't get her boot off. She has... I got to tell you, sometimes it's hard not to pick up on some things, but Terry has two broken screws in her ankle. All right? So, I don't know if that means they're going to have to replace them or not. So, be in prayer. All right? There's no way that you or I can comprehend what the Lord suffered during those hours of darkness when he who knew no sin was made sin for us. There is something significant that is happening with the statement, though. During Jesus' time, there was a teaching and an educational practice that the religious leaders would often use. They would quote the first verse of a section of Scripture or the first statement dealing with a key story to bring to mind the full event of that passage of Scripture. It would be like me quoting just simply Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, simply to summarize the entire creation story or to remind you of it. Everything that Jesus did was intentional. You and I need to understand that. He was in full control, full charge. These things weren't just coming off the cuff. No, Jesus knew exactly what he was doing. This was all planned out before the cross. Excuse me, folks, just a moment, if you will. When the 3 hours were up and God had placed all of humanity's sin on Jesus, Jesus raised himself up on the cross and he cried out with a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me? Now, we've said this before, but how many of you remember where that verse comes from? Where we see it? Prior to the cross. We see it hundreds of years before. It is the first line of the 22nd Psalm, that messianic psalm, which opens, my God, why have you forsaken me? It begins with that question and then goes on for several verses describing the sins of the people. And as you read it, you realize that you've been reading about what will happen on the cross to Jesus. Paul describes what people will, or the psalm describes what people will say and do to Jesus on the cross. But it does something else. By the time you get to the end of Psalm 22, you start reading about how God delivers and how he provides everlasting joy and how people will worship him because of the great things he's done and how his people will tell this story of tragedy to triumph from one generation to another. It would have immediately, for all those around, drawn their mind to the 22nd Psalm. Remember, this psalm was prominently read during the Passover by the rabbis. By saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus is telling us that he paid the price for sin so that we would not have to. He was abandoned by God so that you would never be abandoned by God. He was forsaken so that you could be forgiven. He was punished so that you could be pardoned. He took your unrighteousness and gave you his righteousness. I've encouraged you more than once to go back and take a look at that 22nd Psalm, pray through it, piece by piece, look at it, put it up next to the the passion story, and let God just really bless you with it. Jesus wasn't asking this question because he was looking for an answer. No, he knew. He cried out this question from the cross so that you and I would look for the answer. Because he knew that we would discover the answer. And when we did, we would know that the answer was that God had planned to save us, forgive us, and make us a part of his family. That plan of salvation was for Jesus to be abandoned so that you and I would be accepted. But there's one more thing that we need to see here. I said there were three, and the third one is this. The death of Jesus reveals the very grace of God. Look with me, if you will, to verses 35 through 38. When some of the bystanders heard it, they began saying, "Behold, he's calling for Elijah." Someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine and put it on a reed, gave it to him to drink, saying, "Let us see whether Elijah comes to take him down." Jesus uttered a loud cry, breathed his last, and the veil of the temple was torn from top to bottom. Let me show you layout of the picture of the tabernacle or the temple where the sacrifices were offered to God. At one end, you have the door. As you come through the door, you have the outer court. In the outer court, you remember there's the brazen altar where all the sacrifice was made. And then halfway between the brazen altar and the door to the tabernacle, the door to the inner court, you have the brazen laver. It was filled with water, and during the day, as the priests went about their duty, they would go and they would wash their hands, and they would always wash themselves before they would enter into the holy place. You go through that door, you come to the holy place. And there in the holy place, you have the table of showbread with the 12 loaves of unleavened bread, the golden candlestick representing the Holy Spirit in his illuminating work. Of course, the table of showbread shows us that the Word of God. At the altar of incense, just before that great veil, you have praise and worship, prayer. Then you have the veil. The veil, which represents the very, if you will, we pass into the, by a new and living way, through the veil, that is to say, through him, represents the barrier between God and man that we have to go through to get to God. Well, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through him. So that veil does represent our Lord, who is taken out of the way. This is taken out of the way in Christ. And then you get to the Ark of the Covenant, which is the presence of the Father. This can get complicated, but I'm going to do everything I can to keep it as simple and straightforward as I can. During Old Testament times, before Jesus died on the cross, a chosen priest, you know, would make sacrifice on behalf of the people. And part of this worship included that the high priest going through the door and entering into the inner court, past the brazen altar, to the holy place, and eventually make his way to the Holy of Holies. And this is where the Ark of the Covenant was kept. And the priest would enter the presence of God there. Between the holy place and the Holy of Holies was this large curtain. In the temple, it was about 80 feet tall and about 3 inches thick. the width of a man's hand, according to Josephus. Yeah, width, there we go. You know, about yay thick. The curtain was a symbolic of the barrier between God and his people. And everything in the temple symbolized and pointed to Jesus in some way. Even what the priest wore, what he did, all illuminated or pointed to Jesus in some way. When Mark says the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, he's referring to that 3 to 4 inch thick linen woven curtain between the holy place and the holy holies. And that veil, which symbolizes separation between God and man due to sin, now through the death of Jesus, was torn in two, and Jesus had opened for the whole world a new and living way, as Hebrews 10 says. That is through his flesh. Tore it open. I want you to know the significance, because that curtain did not tear by human hands. It was torn by the very hands of God from top to bottom. I want you to consider something. Have you ever seen these strong men tear phone books? And were wowed at that? I've never seen one tear a phone book that is between 3 and 4 inches thick. But I want you to consider how strong woven linen material would be woven together that thick. Yet it's as if it was a simple piece of paper, and God just took and you know, I know I'm somewhere around here. I've got to have, you know, here we go. You know, he just simply took and very simply did this. Think about the majesty of all of that. Now, if you will, think about being a priest, ministering in the temple. We know there's an earthquake going on. And he looks up and he hears this gigantic, ear-shattering rip as the fabric of the temple is torn in two. Folks, I think he would have thought he's going to drop dead. You know why? Because nobody's eyes could behold in the Holy Holies. Now, the Ark of the Covenant was no longer there. It's been gone for centuries. Some think Nebuchadnezzar took it off in captivity. Some thinks it was gone before Nebuchadnezzar sacked the temple. But at any rate, at the time of Jesus, the Ark of the Covenant wasn't there. It was just a bare rock where it sat, covered with millennia, centuries of blood. Tearing the curtain indicated that through Jesus' death on the cross, all people now had access to God. Jesus was the once for all sacrifice for all our sins. I was going to do this, but I didn't put it up there. But I want you to go with me to Hebrews and chapter 10. Just real quickly, if you've got your Bibles open, go to Hebrews and chapter 10. I want you to start with me at verse 12. Well, in verse 11, it begins this way. Every priest stands day by day ministering and offering the same sacrifices time after time, which could never take away sin. But this man, after offering one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down at the right hand of God. He is now waiting until his enemies are made a footstool. For by the one offering, he has perfected forever those who are sanctified. Verse 15. The Holy Spirit also testifies to us about this, For after he says, this is the covenant I will make with them. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my law in their heart and write them on their minds. And he adds, I will never again remember their sins and their lawless acts. Now, where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer an offering for sin. Verse 19. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have boldness to enter the sanctuary through the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, he is opened for us through the curtain that is his flesh. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, our bodies washed in pure water. Let us hold on to the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. And let us be concerned about one another in order to promote love and good works, not straying away from our worship meetings as some habitually do, but encouraging each other, and all the more as we see the day is drawing near. What day? The return of our King. Grace has been revealed by our God. The darkness on the cross was not the end of the story. It was just a demonstration of God dealing with my sin, judging my sin, showing me mercy, bringing me grace. God at work. Even in the midst of the darkness. So how can we put a cap on this and go forward? Well, the cross shows us the seriousness of our sin, but it also shows us the immeasurable love of God. Take a look at thought I put that verse up there, but maybe not. 1 Peter 3:18 says, Christ suffered for your sins once for all. He never sinned, but he died for sinners to bring you safely home to God. He suffered physical death, but was raised to life in the Spirit. That darkness reminds us that we're sinners. And God decided to judge and deal with our sin on the cross. Jesus took our punishment. That, my friends, is mercy. The question by Jesus from the cross, why have you forsaken me, was not so Jesus would get an answer, but that you and I could find the answer. He was rejected so that we would not have to be. And that is divine love. The temple curtain was ripped from top to bottom to demonstrate that Jesus opened the way of access for all people to God. And through Jesus, we can all come boldly to the throne of grace. And that, my friends, is divine grace. For us who are followers of Jesus, we sometimes need to pause. Frequently, I think, would be more like it, if we would, and just say, Jesus, I don't fully understand. I certainly cannot comprehend all that you went through for me. But I thank you, God, that you did. And if you're one that is listening out there, and you're not yet a follower of Christ, then I want you to know that all this happened for you. Yes, Jesus died on the cross to bring you safely home to God. That's mercy. That's love. And that's grace. When we come back Monday, we'll open up with this, the seven sayings from the cross. In order to do that, we'll of course have to bounce into some of the other gospels, but that's okay. Don't want to leave the cross without hearing the voice of God from the cross and what we can learn from that. Good to have you with us this morning. Thank you for your faithfulness. Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you so very much for your love, for your mercy and love and grace shown to us in such a spectacular way. God, may we just simply spend part of this day, if not all of it, Lord, as we go through it, adoring you with praise and thanksgiving on our lips for what transpired that day. I know, Lord, in just a few weeks we come into the Easter season. We'll be looking at all this all over again. So keep it fresh. Maybe, Lord, this might be the first Easter season that we come in where we've spent all this time immersed, ready then for what you have for us. Oh God, thank you for loving us so, so spectacularly. Bless us now, Lord. And as we go through this weekend, I just pray, God, you use us as you see fit. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Sunday, we're going to be looking at Romans 12:2 again, particularly what it means what it looks like to the renewing of the mind, that we are to be transformed, metamorphosized, and the process is through the renewing of the mind. Let's join together. Let's see what God has for us. I'll see you Sunday morning, and then Monday I'll be, you know, back here at 9, we're going to be picking up on the seven sayings from the cross. May God bless you, and we'll see you then.